know, I was looking forward to this show, but now I'm not anymore.
You looked good in some of those older clips.
Can I introduce the guy on camera right now who thinks he's got a good sense of humor? Matt Servitto. I just met a few minutes ago.
We're just going to sit here and bust each other, right?
Let me ask you something. Okay. Do you think because we happen to be Italian-American from a certain part of the country, mm-hmm. with a certain kind of personality, that you can just say anything on my show? You can offend me and say I look younger in those clips?
I'm sorry, is this going to be edited out? Are we? How does this work?
No, we're on the air.
Where's my teleprompter?
No, there is no teleprompter. First of all, Matt, can I give him some credits here before we run another clip? On The Sopranos, he in fact played Special Agent Dwight Harris. Mm-hmm. What a great role. On Billions, one of my favorite show, you are Bob Sweeney.
Buffalo Bob Sweeney.
From upstate New York, involved in politics a little bit.
Yes, the mayor of Buffalo at the moment on the show.
Okay, this is going to be seen later. Let me also say that Matt told me what was going to happen in the series. Now I don't have to watch anymore. So,
it's because I had explained the show to you. It was kind of like, you know, subtitled for you.
Stop it. What's the other one? Oh, yeah, on your. We're about to show you play Satan on the Adult Swim television series. Your Pretty Face is Going to Hell, fourth season?
Yeah.
Describe that.
It's a workplace comedy set in hell. That is in its fourth season. We basically, everybody works for Satan. The show looks like The Muppets on Acid, and it's touched by an angel in reverse. Basically, Satan sends them up to Earth to do bad things, and they do those bad things very badly and come back and tell me how bad they did at it. But as opposed to Touched by an Angel, where he sends them down, they do good things, right, and they go back to heaven. But it really is The Office meeting a Bosch painting. It's just kind of looks insane. You're not our demo, because our demo is probably 15 to 25. No guys over 6.
You think the show's actually going to air?
Yeah, I'm sure. Believe me. I know. This is all just getting me away from my wife and kids for half an hour. Thank you.
Hey, speaking of your kids, yes. Can I make a mention?
Go ahead, please.
So you got a little extra makeup done today.
I did. Lauren did an amazing job. I came in here looking like Jerry Cooney, and she has kind of fixed me up to look like a claymation figure. I got to go over here.
Did you get in a fight?
Stitches. The good news is, Steve, that my son's fastball is jumping at about 60 miles an hour. He's 12 years old.
Wow.
The bad news is I found that out by taking it to the face. I was sort of a radar gun for his fastball. And there was a lot of blood and stitches, and it was just my slow reaction. That's all it was. I did not catch the ball fast enough.
Can we run the clip from Your Pretty Face is Going to Hell? Can we run the clip? Let's go.
Sure, you've all heard the rumors by now about the possible layoffs. They're not true. Here's the problem. Souls are way down, all right? So I've decided to try something a little different, all right? Eddie! Oh, yeah. This could be your future. Take a look at this.
Eddie.
Positive, reinforce. Spotted gallon low there, Eddie.
Oh, no, it's hot down here, sir. It's probably evaporation.
I'm sorry, where was I?
Now, you were formally trained in acting.
Yes, I was.
Where? At Juilliard.
Yes.
And did you ever envision this kind of work at Juilliard?
No. But as a friend of mine likes to say, says you finally found a home for your style of acting on the Cartoon Network, which is where that Adult Swim airs. No, but this is, I call that acting sorbet. As a guy that has spent 30 years playing cops and robbers and firemen and lawyers and doctors, This cleans the palate. I absolutely get to just be in silly, and we do a ton of improv, and we shoot for about 2 months every year, which is just a blast.
You knew you wanted to go into acting when?
I still haven't figured it out. I'm always in awe of people say, oh, I knew at 5, or I knew at 12. I mean, I was a typical kid growing up. I was born in Jersey, raised here for a while. We moved to Detroit when I was very young, and I was a Midwestern kid, liked sports. I went to an all-boys Catholic prep school, and the only way to meet girls, the only thing we did that was co-ed, was theater. So they happened to do the only play I knew, which was West Side Story, and freshman year, and I got cast. So I did musical theater all through high school, and still was like a lot of fun. Having fun, great. I think I actually wanted to be a journalist. I was going to like go study journalism, mm-hmm. political science, and theater teacher said, I bet I can get you a scholarship to the local college. And I was like, and he did. So I started at Wayne State in Detroit. And again, was just sort of studying and thinking, maybe I'll go into English, I'll teach. But then I went to England. I was in a car accident. I'm prone to, and I got some money in a settlement and used it to study a semester in England. And that's when I fell in love with acting.
I've been working ever since.
Yeah.
You work a lot.
I do. I always say, you know, I get called the hardest working actor in New York, and I think it's, I think what they're saying is that I have to work really hard to be a good actor.
No, it means that you're versatile and can do a lot of things.
Thank you, Steve.
Stop.
Thank you.
Can we do the Sopranos?
Yeah, let's talk about it.
Gandolfini.
Yeah.
What was he like?
I've been thinking about Jimmy a lot. I mean, because obviously with the 20th anniversary is happening right now of the airing of the show, and I know his son Michael, and I'm very excited about what's happening with the film that
they're
making.
And Michael's in it.
Yeah, playing his dad, playing his father in flashbacks. Just incredible. It gives me chills talking about it. But Jimmy was exactly what everyone so often in my business. What people's perception or what they think of people is never, you know, what they actually are like. But Jimmy just had a reputation as a big teddy bear, nicest guy in the business, and that is all true. Sort of was the patriarch of the show, took care of people, did things, many things that most of us never talk about because Jimmy asked us not to, just things he did financially, things he did charity, things he did, you know, he was just a giver somebody who loved his role as, you know, the patriarch, but also hated publicity, never did talk shows.
Right.
You know, he did not like the spotlight. And I don't think I've ever worked with somebody who became a bit of a rock star who hated it. I mean, first year...
The fame?
Yeah, the first year or two when we would go
the
out.
Work he loved. He loved
the work. Jimmy loved working, you know, and loved to constantly have something on the burner. But... the first year or two when the show was on, we could go out in the city and have a good time and people would leave Jimmy alone. But then by season three, you'd go out with the Sopranos, you were out with Led Zeppelin 1969, you're out with rock stars.
We had Michael Imperioli on in our Tisch W&AT studio, check that interview out. You were all part of a very special cast. It felt like a family kind of thing. Am I overestimating that?
No, I mean, I know, again, like, you know, when you're trafficking those cliches from the business, but yeah, I mean, it really was like a family, and we hung out a lot together. Whenever somebody would get, you know, whacked off the show, we would have a wake. We'd go to Little Italy and drink wine and say goodbye to them, and, you know, but it's a show that still kind of pulls on all my, you know, all the emotions, and yeah. I'm still in touch with a lot of the guys from the show.
Real quick, so Homeland.
Yeah.
Set that up real quick, 30 seconds.
Homeland, I got to spend season 7 with Manny Patinkin and, you know, be in his shadow and be in his aura. I just was such a huge fan of the show. It was a real treat to work with him, another fellow Juilliard alum, and just kind of, you know, learn from him and watch his process. And so that was a blast, and now they're finishing up with season 8, just about done with the show.
Let's go to the clip.
Who is that?
O'Keefe, we're arranging to move the kid to a hospital.
No, not until I get my man back.
Kid's bleeding out. Your man shot him.
Raised a weapon.
16-year-old, they shot him. Do not fuck with me on this. You will not like where it ends up.
Respectfully, you have no chain of command here. Take it up with the director.
So strong, just a few seconds, really strong.
It's tough. You got to go toe-to-toe with Manny. Yeah. It's that's tough.
Good stuff. By the way, you want to take back anything you said earlier in the show about me?
No, actually, I'll put more online for anybody that wants to watch. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, Matt. By the way, stay. Watch the curveball. Watch the fastball.
Yeah.
Okay.
Listen.
Just watch out. All right.
Thank you.
We'll be right back right after this.
One on One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating over 30 years of broadcast excellence. Funding for this edition of One on One with Steve Adubato has been provided by the Turrell Fund, supporting right from the start NJ, Atlantic Health System, NJM Insurance Group, Summit Medical Group, New Jersey Resources, PNC Bank, and by Suez, transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.